Filmmaker John Huston, speaking about his own career and the making of movies, said, "What you try to become is a bringer of magic, for magic and truth are closely allied, and movies are sheer magic. When they're misused, of course, it's a debasement of magic, but when they work, well, it's glorious. The ideal movie," he said, "seems to me to be the one where the spectator projects what he wants to see on the screen, as if he had both camera and projector inside his own head." And we'll be right back with John Huston and film. John Huston is with us. As this was beginning, I had a voiceover offering your definition of the magic of movie making and how magic and movies can be allied. And it seems extraordinary to me, I must tell you, after having sat across from a number of your friends, colleagues, and people who've told stories, that I can be aware of the fact that your film, based on Flannery O'Connor's Wise Blood, had the phenomenal reception it had at the Cannes Festival, to great acclaim in the French critics, that you have done a cameo part in a new film called Head On, you are about to direct a film called Phobia, and we get the news from Hollywood that in the middle of all of this, you have a commitment to make a film called Escape to Victory with Sylvester Stallone and Michael Caine. Yes. Can I assume you are now booked through 1980?
Yes, I have to stand tiptoe to see over my engagements.
How long has it been since you've been in Canada?
I haven't been here since I came up. I realized just the other day that there had been another visit to Canada than I had remembered. I came up to publicize the Bible. That must be, 10 or 12 years ago.
Were you in Toronto, Montreal?
In Toronto.
Did you get west at all,
no,
Vancouver?
No, to Toronto.
No?
My father's family, comes from Toronto.
Yes, I know.
My father was born in Toronto. And the Hustons, I went up the other day, and saw my great-grandfather's farm in a Huston farm in Orangeville.
I always thought it was extraordinary that perhaps two of the most acclaimed performances of Abraham Lincoln happened to come from Walter Huston and Raymond Massey,
both
born in Toronto.
Sure.
And then, of course, I'm not forgetting that you did Abe Lincoln in Illinois for the WPA workshop in Chicago. Mm-hmm. How was your Abe Lincoln?
I think rather crippled and lame, if not broken down. Besides my father, I don't think that was his best performance by any means, any more than it was D.W.'s best picture.
Did you ever see Raymond Massey's?
Yeah, which was very good. Very good.
When you say
the play, I only saw him in the play.
Yes. I think of you being a teenager and being in New York with your father and being able to observe Eugene O'Neill directing your father in Desire Under the Elms. And you said you learned more about staging a scene from Eugene O'Neill than anyone.
Yes,
how?
O'Neill wasn't doing the staging himself, actually. It was Robert Edmund Jones. They were doing Desire Under the Elms. Those being present at those rehearsals was, I think, probably the biggest influence, certainly I'd ever had up till that time, and maybe the biggest I've ever had. I did learn something about writing and directing, because it was fine acting. And very intelligent direction from Jones, who was a great figure and power in the theater at that time, through his own genius as a designer and director, and then of course these magnificent words.
You've had some extraordinary comments when you say, when people ask you about directing your father and directing your daughter, as you did, I gather, as a birthday present when you gave her A Walk with Love and Death.
That's right.
But you said, on a movie set, the director becomes the father. When I directed my father, I became my own grandfather. What happened with your daughter when you found yourself back to being a father?
It was very interesting. It was easier, I think, directing my father than was my daughter. And she was not particularly keen about doing the film. I wanted to do it more than she did. She's come around now to where she's contemplating becoming an actress again. But at that time, she didn't take too happy a view of the whole thing. She had her doubts, and then when they went to publicize the picture afterwards, she flatly refused to do anything for it.
Is her name pronounced Angelica?
No, Angelica.
It is Angelica?
Angelica.
Didn't you also have a dilemma when you were preparing that film and you found out that none of the insurance company would insure Moishe Dayan's son because of the problem of threats on his life?
I remember something vaguely about this, but it had gone from my mind. Yes.
Why didn't Angelica do more acting? She did go to London and work with Tony Richardson. She did Ophelia in his production of Hamlet in London.
No?
No. I thought she replaced Marianne Faithfull in London on the stage.
Oh, you're right. You are right. Yes. Of course. You're right. And did very nicely. Did very nicely. I didn't see it. I was away making a film. That's why. But did very well, I'm told. I think she was, I think she just didn't want to make motion pictures and be a star. For pretty good reasons. I rather admired her for her stand.
I thought you admired her too because you said she asked so many questions. Wasn't that a problem on A Walk with Love and Death? You had a daughter who was asking you why all the time?
Well, she's asked me why all her life, on stage and off. So, nothing remarkable there.
You recently became a grandfather for the first time through your son, Tony.
My son, Tony, had my first grandson, first grandchild named Matthew.
And what is your son doing in London?
He's writing. He spends a lot of his time in Ireland. His wife, Lady Margot, is one of the most delightful women, just charming, beautiful, intelligent. I don't see how he ever got her.
How do you divide the year? How much time of the year do you spend in Puerto Vallarta and how much time is in Ireland? Is it seasonal?
No. I work a lot of the time, and when I'm not working, now I go to Mexico. And then whenever my heart impels me, I go shooting off to Ireland. But those are sentimental visits now.
There were many stories about you and Irving Swifty Lazar having a number of luncheon meetings in New York City with publishers, and how Swifty Lazar, who was a legend as an agent, would tell anecdotes about the wonderful stories John Huston was going to put into his autobiography. And there were rumors in New York that Knopf had given you an advance of $200,000. But only a matter of weeks ago, you finished the autobiography. Do they now have it? Is it with them?
I finished the autobiography day before yesterday. And the Charles Elliott, the senior editor of Knopf, came up to Canada to get it. Came up and stayed at the hotel and went back with it. We went over the manuscript once more and he went back with it.
Are you going to use the title Long Shadow?
No, I don't think so. I don't know yet what I'm going to call it, but what they're going to call it, because this is something that the author himself doesn't decide all alone, I discover. My nomination is Résumé.
Sounds good. Mm-hmm. Let us take a commercial break,
sure.
And we'll come right back. Be right back with John Huston and more. John Huston is with us. We've been talking about film, filmmaking, the people you've worked with. There are so many extraordinary stories, and I am looking forward to your autobiography, and I'm happy to know that the senior editor from Knopf has taken it away, which means it's out of your possession. Wasn't there a time when you didn't think you would finish it at all? You didn't want to be personal, and you found the most fun working on it was talking about the early days in Mexico and Ireland?
I don't quite know how I got into it, except through Swift to Lazar. An old friend, by the way, is Irving Lazar. I found myself having luncheons, as you said, in New York with publishers, and then being whisked off by Swifty to a publisher's, to his offices. And we did the whole roster of publishers. And my God, I was in a whirl. I didn't know where I was or who I was talking to or why. And then went away, and presently Swifty said that Knopf wanted to do it, and he painted a very lively and easy picture of what a simple procedure it would be. I had a boat down in Mexico, and I'd just talk in the boat to a recorder, and then whenever a marlin struck, I'd get up and pull the fish in, and then go back and continue my monologue to the recording device, tape. It didn't work out that way at all. It became a very hard thing to write. With the help of other people, was very difficult indeed. And there were parts of my life that I didn't particularly care to review. Anyway, I waded through it and became interested finally. It stopped being a chore and became a, not exactly a self-analysis, but as close as one could get to that, as close as I could get to such a thing. There was no attempt to recapitulate, to tell the whole story, nor is it a confession. I don't bend over and spread my cheeks, as it were. But it's been quite an experience.
Don't you think it's important, though, when there have already been five books on John Huston, that John Huston sit down and resolve, as people like Lauren Bacall have said, your friend, Lauren Bacall, the reason she wrote the book about herself and Humphrey Bogart was she got fed up with picking up other people's books and reading things that weren't true.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've religiously avoided reading anything about myself. I never do. Most of the people, the only book about me that where I've had any meetings with the author is your man, the head of your film board here,
Gerald Pratley, of course.
Who was the only one, and he's written, I understand, a good book. I can't bear to read what people write about me. It makes me uncomfortable, embarrasses me. But I understand Gerald Pratley's is very good. The others, I think, for the most part, were just gathered from the morgues of newspapers and assembling other people's writing.
Tell us why your friend Humphrey Bogart used to refer to you affectionately as the monster. Wasn't that one of his pet terms for you?
Yes. I think that was largely because I'd take him off two places, to make films where he had no desire to be. Bogie liked his own hearth, and and to drink drink his scotch and sodas in the luxury of his own study or drawing room. And he'd find himself down in the badlands of Mexico or the heart of dark heart of Africa with me, and didn't know why, except that he said yes at some mistaken moment.
But when I think of you being in the Congo for 10 weeks with Katharine Hepburn, Humphrey Bogart, and Hepburn loving every minute of it, mm-hmm. and enjoying it. Of course, she had her portable dressing room, her portable toilet, all of those wonderful things built for her.
But they didn't last very long.
They didn't?
Oh, no.
Why not, John?
Well, most of the shooting was done on the river. And the power boat was the actual queen, the African queen, furnished the power to pull the other boats, which were mostly rafts, up the river. And we'd go up against the current and then turn around several miles up and come back down and shoot on the way down. Of course, the sound of the engines going up the river would made sound shooting impossible going up. and also the current had to be taken us towards the lake, so it had to be downstream. In any case, Katie's dressing room and toilet were the straw that broke the camel's back. The little powerboat could pull all the other equipment up, but that was just that little bit too much. So she had to be deprived of those luxuries.
Let us take another commercial break, all right? Be right back with John Huston and more right after this. John Huston is with us. We were talking about Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn and the African Queen, and I was sharing a story with you that Miss Hepburn had told about the day you told her to get into the river and climb on the boat, and she was aware of the fact that the river was crocodile infested. And you said, "Don't worry about it, Kate. I'll have one of the prop men shoot a few rounds into the water, and the noise will scare the crocodiles away." And Hepburn is supposed to have looked at you and said, "Yes, John, but what about the deaf ones?"
That sounds like Katie.
Now, what was Robert Morley doing in the middle of all of this?
Well, Bob wasn't in Africa with us. We did the scene with Bob. We shot the scenes where others were in the same scene with him. We shot that part, half of the scenes in Africa. But his part we shot the interior, and when he was preaching and so on in England, in London. You were telling me that Robert had many stories about
you.
About me. Well, I've got one about Bob. It's one of my favorites about him. I simply adore the man. I think he's one of the most amusing, wittiest men alive. I'm sure that Bob would have held his own with Oscar Wilde or anyone. Anyway, I was at the races one time in London, outside London, Bob. And I don't know of anyone, I should preface, that has the presence that Bob has. I mean, the wonderful gift of gab, the immediate rejoinder, the apt comment. We watched a race, a horse won, and it was a selling race. They were going to auction the horse off after the race. So Bob said, "Come on, let's go out and watch it." And we went down to the ring, and they were auctioning the horse. And it was a cheap race, And the bids weren't very high, very low. £500, £600, which was, of course, nothing for a racehorse. And Bob said, "John, let's buy him." And I said, "No, no, we don't want that dog." But he said, "It's so cheap, at least it's a winner." He said, "The horse just won a race." I said, "Yes, but Bob is no good." I said, "You know." And Bob said, "Come on, let's buy him, let's buy him." And he got my hand, and he wanted to be partners with me in the purchase of the horse. So he got my hand, and he was trying to pull my hand up, and I was resisting him. It wasn't a horse to buy. And I was fighting Bob to not buy the horse when the auctioneer said, for whatever it was, pounds and pounds or something, sold. And as the auctioneer said, sold, the horse fell over dead. The horse was sold. The man had bought the horse. And for the only time in my whole experience with Bob, he didn't have a word. No comment, whatever. He just hung there with his mouth open.
I can't think of, you remind me when you tell that story about Robert Morley, about the time when you were first in New York City, and your friend for most of your life, Sam Jaffe, was your birthday party, and they brought a horse into the apartment. I mean, horses have always been an important
part. Played quite a role
part
in my life, yes, yes, quite.
Did the heart surgery slow you down? People keep saying John Huston comes out of the hospital and he acts in this, he directs this, another announcement is made. What changes did heart surgery bring upon you, if any?
No, none whatever. It wasn't heart surgery, by the way. It was an aneurysm of the aortal artery, which is quite different from heart surgery. Just as serious, but in a different location and a different procedure. It's made no, no. I can't tell him. I don't feel any different than I did before.
See, that doesn't surprise me.
But the thing is, there was no reason to feel badly before with what I had. You either die from, right now, or they fix it.
I was going to tell you that. Your saying that to me doesn't surprise me, because I remember the story of John Huston being 12 years old and being put in a sanatorium with a heart murmur and having every breath taken care of and watched. And at night, when everyone went to sleep, you left your room and went swimming in icy water by a waterfall. And as a child, had some understanding that this might improve your condition. And it did, didn't it?
I don't know that it improved my, I don't, that wasn't why I went anyway. I went just to go swimming.
All right. We'll take another break on that. Be right back with John Huston. John Huston is with us. We've been talking around Robert Morley, other people in film. You made a statement at one point. You were speaking to someone on the New York Times, and you were saying, I think it was in 76 or 7, that in the past decade, you had made, in your opinion, three good films. And you referred to Reflections in a Golden Eye, The Man Who Would Be King, which of course was a dream of yours for some time and became a reality, and Fat City. Now, having mentioned those three films, is Wise Blood now a film that you would include in that group?
Oh, yes. Yes. I wasn't prepared for the reception that Wise Blood has had. It was shown in New York at the New York Film Festival, and marvelously, wonderfully well received, way, way beyond my expectations. As a matter of fact, I did it rather as an obeisance to quality, without any expectation of reward. critical or monitory. And so what's happened is so much velvet.
But you were prepared for the New York reception after that reception at the Cannes Festival.
Yes, more or less prepared. Needless to say, I'm delighted.
When I mention those other three films and one...
You're quite right. Those are the ones I like.
Yes. Mm. I like them too. Yeah. But then as you have admitted in the past, many people will come to you and tell you how very much they like The Misfits, mm-hmm. which I liked. And I was always astonished because there was a story. Did you ever, after The Misfits, consider, since you already had Montgomery Clift for Freud, yes. of using Marilyn Monroe in Freud?
Yes. Yes. As a matter of fact, I'd thought of her before doing The Misfits. And it wasn't I who first thought of her. It was Jean-Paul Sartre.
Really?
Yeah. Which surprised me, and I thought, yes.
What did you and Jean-Paul Sartre see in Marilyn Monroe then that you both thought she could be in that film?
Well, it was the part of the young woman. And she could have adapted to it. It was proposed to Marilyn, and she didn't do it. She refused. She wanted to do it at first, and then she was dissuaded from it by her analyst. The daughter of Sigmund Freud, Anna Freud, was against any film being done about her father, and this was his reason, the analyst's reason for advising Marilyn not to do it. I don't know that it would have made any difference if she had. I'm not talking about the picture, but I'm talking about her. I think that it would probably have ended, so far as she was concerned, the same way. But there's always that conjecture that one wonders.
I think and you must tell me if this is true, the story about Marilyn Monroe coming in to read for you for The Asphalt Jungle. Mm-hmm. Did she really ask your permission to lie down on the floor
yeah.
and read from the floor?
Yes, yeah. Yes, that's not extraordinary.
Though. No?
I mean, something, yes, that's not, I mean, that could happen. I've had, when people read, they, and it lent itself, the scene lent itself to that. There was no sofa available. So she lay down on the floor and read the scene very well, may I add.
When you talk about actors the way you do, and you have the generosity, you talk about not being a director who gives line readings and tells actors what to do. And when you work with someone like Marlon Brando and Elizabeth Taylor, and you do Carson McCullough's Reflections in a Golden Eye, and you said you just stood back and watched this phenomenon of Marlon Brando, mm-hmm. having worked with the people you've worked with, and I refer to the people you saw on the stage, from your own father, to the film personalities. What is it about Brando for you that makes him an acting phenomenon?
He has that ability to surprise one. It's never the cliche that he serves up in the reading of a line. I think something that Marlon said to me, or in my presence at least one time, it tells about him. He doesn't try to please anyone, to please the audience. He doesn't think about the audience. There's no wish to please when he does a part. He's only concerned with the thing itself. There is no third presence there, so to speak. And he'll turn a line inside out. He'll show you something about it, about not simply the line, but the character that you didn't know was there, a further revelation. That's about as well as I can say it.
Did your friend Elizabeth Taylor ever possess that quality?
She is a very fine actress. I think all good actors, to some extent, possess this quality. But Marlon has a rare, if not unique, power to surprise you with a reading or an action or emotion or what he does, even if it's just a timing. I remember seeing Julius Caesar, and I was in England, and there were a number of the actors of the English school there, Gielgud and Olivier and so on, and they were rather stunned. I don't think that since the advent of Jack Barrymore and his Hamlet, they'd encountered anything like this from an American. And he made them look like academics or academicians. he made them look studied and pedantic. This utterly strange rendering of Anthony, this pure fire, sort of a furnace door was opened and you looked into its hot depths. they in their tradition at first recoiled, then shook their heads, then wiped their brows and nodded.
Let us take another break, all right? Be right back with John Huston.
That part.
Yes. John Huston is back with us. We've been talking about acting and about your experiences. Whether we think of the first film in 1941, and people often say about John Huston, it's tough when you start your career directing the Maltese Falcon. And people talk about you in the film industry the way they talk about your friend Orson Welles. And what's imposed upon men like you who, however much you may have done before, which is always minimized, you have the kind of impact you have, whether it's Welles, Citizen Kane, or your Maltese Falcon, and everything after that is keeping up with yourself for everybody except you, because you're going along anyway. And I bring this up because people talk about you acting, or the time Otto Preminger telephoned you and offered you the role in The Cardinal, which was your film debut as an actor, and you were reluctant until he said you could play The Cardinal. Why did you say yes to Otto Preminger?
Oh, I didn't hesitate. I was an old friend, and I thought it would be a lark. And that's the way I've always regarded my acting ever since. Never all that seriously.
But when you have a situation and you take a wonderful group of actors like Stacy Keach and Jeff Bridges, and you're in Stockton, California, and you're doing Fat City, and we know about John Huston's days as an amateur boxer, and a rather good one, I just feel that being aware of you in the ring and your friendships with boxers, was that as personal a film as I think it was for you?
Oh, yes, yes. As a matter of fact, there was one old fighter in there that I'd boxed with when I was a kid. I was professional, you know. I enjoyed making the picture, every minute of it, enormously. It was very interesting experience because a lot of the people were not actors. If you remember, you saw the film?
Yes.
There was a black man who did a scene hoeing a row beside Stacy, told the story of his marriage and how it went on the rocks through wine in the afternoon with another woman. I gave, there was a man brought in, several, I've heard several men read, and several black men read. And this man, an elderly man, who'd once been a boxer, by the way, came in and read. And he had never acted in his life. And he read beautifully, beautifully. He was getting on, he was and a bit of a wreck. And but he read as though the words were his own. It was a poetry and flow to them. And so when he'd finished, I said, do you think you could remember these lines? And he said yes. He knew he could. In fact, he had. He said, I can't read. They were read to me, and I learned them. so he pretended to read for me. He played the part, and just, I thought, beautifully.
I agree.
Wonderfully.
When you have everyone assembled, and you're in Morocco, and you have Sean Connery, and Michael Caine, and Shakira Caine, and you are realizing a dream that is 30 years old happening in front of you. And at one time, that dream involved Humphrey Bogart and Clark Gable. And at another time, Peter O'Toole and Richard Burton. Were there ever private moments for you during the making of that wonderful film, The Man Who Would Be King, where you actually paused and thought of Bogart and Gable? Did your mind go back to all the years you'd waited to do that?
Well, I'd pretty well explored all those ruminations by the time the camera started turning. Yes, it had a long history.
Is that in the autobiography?
Yes.
See, I'm asking you questions, and I'm waiting for the autobiography to come out, and I will find a lot of things in there, I'm sure, that I didn't know about. I just think that is, as obviously millions of other people do, the adventure film. I mean, you are the man who can say that you spent so much time reading Kipling that if someone began a verse and paused, you could finish it. Mm. And that movie made me feel like a kid again. Mm-hmm. And it was Saturday afternoon. Mm-hmm. And it was just a wonderful, wonderful adventure.
Yes, I'm glad you liked it. I liked it too. It was a wonderful film to make after the whole sort of half a lifetime of effort that had gone into it, and writing it, and having it written, and rewriting it, and going. I went up into Afghanistan and SWAT and Deer, those very remote places were at that time, at least, and too remote ever to take a motion picture crew to. Couldn't have survived. So we settled on the Atlas Mountains and had the Berber people from the hills come down and play the part of extras, and the tribesmen in the picture were Berbers. The two, saw this one too. Well, the two old, the priest, if you recall, very old. He was supposed to be 114. One wonders. I'm not at all sure. I wouldn't vouch for that. But he was very old and very active. And the next chief in line, his cardinal, was in his late 80s, and There were three old men, and after they'd never seen a film. They knew what films were, but they'd never seen one. They'd heard about them. So I brought them down into Marrakesh and ran the film that they were in for them. And they looked at it. And I was very curious to hear what they'd say about it, of course. And they talked between themselves in Berber, so I couldn't follow. There was a translator there, though. By the way, during the picture, I had to speak sometimes what my instructions would have to be translated through four languages: English, French, Arabic, and Berber. Anyway.
You showed them the film. They'd never seen
it. They saw the film. They talked between themselves. And finally, they seemed to arrive at some kind of a conclusion. And I turned to the translator and I said, what do they say? And the oldest of them, the old man, had said, "We will never die."
Wonderful. Yeah. I think we should take a break on that. Be right back. That was Karun. John Huston is with us. We've been talking about film achievements and that wonderful story from the man who would be king. And beginning with your father and Toronto and people like Christopher Plummer, and I can't name every Canadian that has entered your life, but I think of the circumstances of working on The African Queen with Bogart and the screenwriter working with you to change Charlie, his character, from a Cockney to a Canadian so that you could use Bogart's speech pattern.
Yes.
That's fascinating. And that he passed for Canadian, I thought perhaps he said about or because. Mm-hmm. Now I'm waiting to look at the African Queen again. Mm-hmm. But with all of these announcements of everything, you and your associate, longtime associate, Gladys Hill, you have, I think, annually for some time, announced across the river and into the trees.
We're still announcing it.
Are you?
Yes.
Good. Mm-hmm. Keep announcing.
Whether it'll ever be made is quite another matter, but we're announcing.
Then you also say you occasionally are approached and asked about Malcolm Lowry's Under the Volcano, and you say yes, they go away and nothing happens again.
Well, that's been announced too. The same man that did Wise Blood, Michael Fitzgerald. Robert's his father. Michael Fitzgerald wants to do Under the Volcano with me.
I can understand you mixing father and son's name, because
yes,
when you found out his father had translated Homer, the Iliad, and
yes,
what was the other?
And the Odyssey.
The Odyssey. Mm. That's extraordinary.
Mm. Yes. He's an extraordinary family altogether. I'm very fond of them. Michael is a rara avis. He's... I think he's going to do just wonderful things in his life. He's a young man still. His whole procedure, his whole way of going about the making of this picture was just a feather in his cap.
Mm-hmm. But aren't there special circumstances behind your affection for Across the River and Into the Trees? Weren't you actually visiting with Hemingway when he was finishing that?
Yes. I was down there in Cuba with him when he was working on the book. It's certainly not his best book. He didn't tell me what he was working on. I just knew that he was working on a book at the time. But I say it's certainly not his best book, but he tried something and failed. It didn't come off. But it was interesting what he tried. I tried to get the thing I knew he was after into the screenplay. the last thing I did was to write this screenplay. We'll see what happens to it.
When can we expect your autobiography? Will it be out during 1980?
It should be out in the next winter.
Next winter. I look forward to reading it. I want to ask you something. Since your friend Katharine Hepburn has moved from California to New York, have you seen Katharine Hepburn?
I haven't seen her in a long time. No.
Have you seen Peter O'Toole recently?
Yes, I see. Peter comes down to Mexico quite frequently, and I see him there.
Are you ever in Ireland at the same time?
Well, we have been, but not recently. Not in the last few months, or a couple of years even. Peter has a house in Ireland.
Have you seen Richard Burton? Did you see Orson Welles when they were in Canada?
I saw Orson. I've seen Richard. Certainly, I've seen both Richard and Orson. Orson has left now. He's gone. We had our pictures taken together for the studio. And Richard. He says I'm the only person in the world that calls him Dick, but I think of him as Dick. Has a house in Puerto Vallarta.
Very near yours, isn't it?
No, not near mine.
He's in
the town.
That's right.
He's in the town. I'm down the coast. You can only get to me by boat.
You were clever, weren't you?
Well, it's an interesting life that I lead there. I've got a little cove all to myself. I rent it. There's no room for anybody else. And if there were, I've got the cove. I rent it from the Indians. And they get it all back in 20 years. I don't have to worry about that. they get back the whole place, the whole establishment as I've built it.
And you advised your architect to build something temporary that would blend back into the jungle when you were finished.
That's right. Yes. Aren't you well informed? My word, I'm astounded.
Thank you.
How much you know.
I just want to tell you that when you tell us about the house and your life, and you are the same man who announced on the evening of his 50th birthday that you intended to live to be 100, and someone said, how did you do that? And you said, do you remember what you said on how you would live to be 100?
No.
Every night at bedtime, you promised yourself a shot of bourbon in the morning. That way you had something to wake up to.
Yes. Not bourbon.
Jack Daniels?
Sour mash Jack Daniels. Yes. Yes, quite.
The important thing is that the drink was there.
Yeah.
I thank you. This has been a pleasure.
Well, it certainly has been for me. Thank you for having me.
Our pleasure. Mm-hmm.